Jiminy crickets.
Gosh, gee.
What a monster.
Cover three beds.
Let's kill it before it wakes up.
Which end do we kill?
Or I should say, hi ho, and welcome to Book Versus Movie. This is a podcast where we read books that have been adapted into movies, and then we try to decide which we like better, the book or the movie. I am Margot P. of ColoniaBook.com, and this is my good friend and co-host, Margot D. of Brooklyn Fit Chick.
Hi, everyone.
So we are squarely in December. It's even winter here in San Diego, amazingly.
Nice.
We're getting this thing called rain I've heard of before. It's kind of weird. It's a little wet. Yeah, blustery. It's a nice, proper SoCal winter. Do you guys have snow yet?
We're supposed to get snow. It's heavy rain tonight, but we're going to get snow. It's getting cold.
Brooklyn in the snow is so
fantastic.
Pretty. I know. I love it. So we decided, look, if you're new, look. Here's the deal. Yes, this is a podcast about movies that have been adapted from books most of the time. But when the pandemic started, we decided to do a brand new episode every single week. And it's hard to read a massive tome every single week. And so we're picking movies that have been adapted from any literary source. It might be a short story, it might be a children's story like we're talking about today, it might be a magazine article or a play or even a song. This month, we're doing Disney in December. And if you're new, you might be thinking, why aren't they doing holiday films? And the reason is that we've been doing this podcast for 9 years, more or less, and we've done so many holiday films. There's so many, Margot D has been so awesome about loading a lot of them into our feed. There's a bunch of them on Patreon, which she'll tell you about in a minute. And we are still looking for ideas for this month for Disney in December. And you guys are coming up with some great suggestions in our Facebook group. If you'd like to join that group, here's how you can do that.
Yes, we do have a basic Facebook page. If you like that and you write to us there, it's fine. But we're much more interactive in our Facebook group. And sometimes the group themselves do their own polls and things like that, like what we should be covering on the show, which we love, by the way. So let me just make it clear. It's any literary source. It's got to be something we should be able to get our hands on. It can't be something that we have to buy on eBay. And the same thing goes with the video source, the movie source. It has to be on a major streaming app. So if you, as long as it fits those, we'll consider it. We have a private Facebook group where we really do just talk about books and movies. It's Book vs. Movie Podcast Group, and it's private. Ask to join. Come on in. We're on Twitter at Book vs. a Movie and Instagram Book vs. Movie. And in both of those places, you spell out Book vs. a Movie. Please like those, follow us at those places. And also, we have an old-timey email. That's always a great way to reach out to us. And what you do is you spell out Book vs. Movie at gmail.com. And we also have some stickers. I'm actually going to order some stickers. I've been giving them away, Margot, when I've been giving away my book, when selling my book to people.
Ooh, yes. Nice little bonus.
Little promotion. That. But we will send them to you in the mail. So let me think. Yep, that's everything.
And if you want to hear some more of our holiday episodes, or if you would like to help keep us in books and movies, you can also support us on Patreon.
Yes, Patreon. Like Margot says, we have 9 years worth of content. So we're going about 7 years worth of content that we're putting on the Patreon wall. Some of the stuff is free if it's like super old and kind of janky, you know, it's from when we were first starting to record, but go and check it out. We have a couple of very affordable options. We just put up Mr. Swift Goes to Washington, which was based on a story in the 1920s. We've been putting in our regular feed, some of the Christmas episodes, just to get them out there, and then they're going to be gone eventually. Once again, Patreon, Patreon. It's just a place to help us out. And it helps us with the cost of the books and the movies and the hosting costs for the website and things like that. So thank you so much.
Margo.
Yes.
Do you like Christmas?
Do I like Christmas? I love Christmas.
How about cowboys? How do you feel like about cowboys?
Oh, put that together and I'm going to have to like take a walk or something because, yeah.
Well, then this is the perfect time to let you and everybody else know that this episode is brought to you by Kensington's newest title, Colorado Country by Diana Palmer. Now, it sounds like it's just one Christmas cowboy story, but no. Oh, no.
Oh, no.
No, it's a twofer. It's a double feature, if you will, of Christmas cowboys.
Yes, Diana Palmer is a very popular romance writer. She sets a lot of her stories in Colorado. She says it's one of those places, which I've set many of my stories, it's beautiful at any time of year, but especially in winter. So we have two stories here for the price of one. Colorado Country, we have Christmas with My Cowboy, and then there's Christmas Kisses with My Cowboy. So they're all in this one story, but there's two different romances. She's a very popular writer. People love her work. You can also get this on the Libby app or you can get the audiobook, but we're talking about Kensington Press today. Two very sexy romantic stories. Well, let me tell you, Christmas and cowboys, like what is better than that, right? What person doesn't respond to that?
Come on.
Yes.
Actually, you just reminded me, I'm getting ready to travel next week. And since I've already purchased and already read Filmed in Brooklyn, I think I will be purchasing Colorado Country to read on the plane. You and everybody else can find Colorado Country by Diana Palmer wherever books are sold. Find out more at kensingtonbooks.com.
We'd love to get some more reviews in our iTunes. Just quite frankly, I attended a marketing meeting iTunes gives out to podcasters, and it really helps us find our people and helps people find our show. So if you like what you hear, wherever you get this podcast, just leave a few stars, leave a review. That would be amazing. Okay, Margo, are we ready?
Oh gosh. We were just saying before we got on the air, just a warning y'all. Okay. This is our second time that we've done Disney in December because, as I said before, we've done so many holiday movies over so many. Like, I've lost count. Pretty much all of them. Mm-hmm. We didn't do Grandma Got Run Over by a Reindeer. That's pretty much the only one that springs to mind that we didn't do.
That was like a desperation one we were thinking of. And we couldn't do it for a minute.
And then we're like, oh, how about Disney? And somehow, and I'm not saying I'm not going to say anything about the character of Mr. Walt Disney, but somehow every time we talk about a Disney movie, we also have to talk about Nazis. Here's another case. And even last week, although we didn't talk about it, it didn't come up during last week's episode. Last week, we talked about Freaky Friday, mm-hmm. which was so much fun. And our author, this is a very tenuous, this is like the best connection I can make in terms of this is Disney in December. The author, Mary Rogers, is the daughter of Rogers of Rogers and Hammerstein, who wrote The Sound of Music, which, of course, is about Nazis. So there you go. There's your Nazi connection. Your belated Disney Nazi connection from last week. Today, though, we are going to be talking about – oh, I'm feeling a little snarky today. Today we're going to be talking about Adolf Hitler's favorite film. Snow White and the Seven Dwarves. But in all seriousness, it's a groundbreaking.
It's beautiful.
Industry shaking, cultural catalyst. This is a very important movie, and I am very excited to talk about it.
Yeah, it's just that. Look, we're going to the source material, and we've been hearing, I don't know about you, but I've been hearing my whole life about Grimm's fairy tales, and I never really knew what they were. I just knew that, like, a lot of stories, Rumpelstiltskin, I think, comes from there.
Yeah, I had a collection of them when I was a kid. I had a collection from, like, the 1960s or the 1950s.
Yeah.
Illustrated, you know, Grimm's fairy tales. And even then, they had been kind of tidied up, shall we say.
Well, yes.
I didn't read the original until I was in college and, like, reading Women Who Run with the Wolves. And then I started, like, getting into the more scholarly look at it. Because the Grimm's brothers are Grimm. And really interesting, complicated characters in history. I mean, they were extremely prolific. They did a lot, and we owe them a lot. There's some stuff.
Yeah, the stuff being they're born in Germany. Germany was just getting over being taken over by France. So they're like the borders around Europe are constantly changing. 1492 in America, we're always like, oh, Columbus sailed the ocean blue, right? Spain also kicked out all the Jewish people at that time. There are several instances in history where Jewish people were exiled from where they were living. And so the Grimms, they're growing up in Germany. I've been to Germany and Switzerland, and there's like a fluidity with the languages between German and French and Italian and all that stuff. And they were they grew up not rich. They grew up poor, and I think the father died when they were young. And they were very much concerned with keep Germany German, protecting the German language, protecting the German culture, because the French were coming in from everywhere. This is 1812 is when the first time Snow White is published. So it's at the 1800s. All of these are being published mid 18th century up to 1858. This is also, there's a lot of anti-Semitism in England. And there's a lot of, and Dickens has a lot of tropes that he uses, like the bad people always have big, pointy, long noses, and they're very cheap. And it's all this coding he's doing. And there's some of it going on in their tales as well. It's something that kind of pride in German, in German language and in the German culture really manifested itself into, there's a lot of these tales that being an obedient person is the best thing you can be. Being a proud German and being obedient is the best things you can possibly be.
It's the moral that pops up over and over again. If you can pick a moral out, because the thing with these Wilhelm and Jakob, is that the correct pronunciation?
I'm going to say yes. I'm not great in German.
So they were, like Margot said, they had been well-to-do, and then their father died when they were quite young, and they became really rather poor. But they were very smart, and, you know, they did have a start, an education, you know, a good base of an education. So they were able to get into university. They became interested in first studying German medieval history, and that led to this kind of interest in German folklore and then in folk tales in general. And so they kind of there's some key figures like this in history that develop an interest in folklore, and they go around and they collect these stories that are part of an oral tradition. And so, you know, most of the stories that we think of as Grimm's fairy tales, like Red Riding Hood, Snow White, Sleeping Beauty, there are versions of those stories very, very hundreds of years old sometimes that exist in cultures, especially in Europe, you know, all throughout Europe.
Mm-hmm.
And what they did was go and collect these stories and kind of put them all in one place. And yes, set them in sort of a German context, because they most likely were hearing the German version of each of these things. We don't know if these stories originated there. There's no way to know. They also have a version of Cinderella, which we did from the French, right? So there's a lot going on politically, geopolitically at the time. And Germany at the time is not unified, I believe, right? In the early to mid 19th century. And so, like Margo said, there's this whole like burgeoning German nationalism that, you know, it's like the little seeds of that eventually turn into Nazism. It's great generalizing swaths of history. I'm going fast and furious with the history here. But they were really amazing. I mean, just first of all, that alone that they did was quite something. Mm-hmm. And their scholarship is really important. At the end of their lives, they died kind of close to each other. They were two of like nine kids. They were working on a dictionary.
Mm-hmm.
A German dictionary. So they were really important figures. But yes, if you look in the complete canon of their quote-unquote fairy tales, there's like at least a half a dozen overtly, blatantly anti-Semitic stories.
Yes.
Warning against the quote-unquote evils of Judaism. Yeah. So guess who fell in love with these?
Roald Dahl.
Yeah,
probably.
Roald Dahl, among others, when the nationalist movement that gave birth to Nazism happens in the early 20th century, this is something that they really kind of, the Grimm tales, I mean, are something that they hold up as, you know, an example of German excellence and, you know, cultural superiority. They really turn it into a really, really ugly thing. And so, yes, late 1930s, Walt Disney makes this movie. It's reportedly Hitler's favorite film of all time.
That and The Wizard of Oz. Those are big movies. They're big themes. I mean, there's the story itself. We'll dive in as best that we can. But I've heard it's Snow White, and then I saw Snow something else and something.
There's two stories in the Grimm canon. There's two stories with a character called Snow White. They're totally different stories. One is called Snow White and Rose Red, where it's about mm-hmm. two little girls. But we're talking about one that's simply called Snow White. And if I remember correctly, in the Grimm's version, and this is what's a little bit confusing to me. In the Grimm's version, the queen is Snow White's mother, her biological mother.
Right.
Not her stepmother. And sometimes when you read it, it is a stepmother. The mother died. Sometimes you read it like in the Grimm's collection that I had, this was the way the story went. There was a king and a queen, and they had no children. And the queen was wishing and wishing for a little girl who had skin as white as snow for the Nazis, and
lips are red.
Red as blood or roses, I don't remember, and hair as black as ebony. And lo and behold, she gives birth to such a child. I think she dies in childbirth, and then the father, the king, remarries. So he's got a new queen. New queen is gorgeous, but like super vain, what we would call like high maintenance.
Mm-hmm.
Also a little bit witchy, and she's got a magic mirror that she has to like, and very insecure. So she has to check with the mirror every day to be reassured that she is the fairest in the land. And but in some versions, arguably the original Grimm version, this is all the mom. This is all the biological mom. And what doesn't make sense to me about that is this. you wish and wish and wish and wish for a daughter, and then you decide you want to kill her. You want to like stab her heart out.
She wanted it, but she wanted to be the more beautiful one. And that's and so she's wishing by a window, and as she's looking out at the snow falling, and then it's like black painted window frame. The she cuts her finger on something, pricks her finger, and three drops of blood hit the snow. And that's when she knows that she's going to have a daughter. So she has this daughter, and it's sort of like she's using her witchcraft with
that's
her
how
wishing.
I knew.
Well, I know not to do that. So I fit okay. But she manifests this beautiful daughter, and then all of a sudden the daughter, and she's very little. She's 7 years old in the story, by the way.
Yes, thank you. She's a little girl when she runs away.
She's a kid.
Yeah.
And her stepmother or mother, whichever it is like, well, that can't happen. Like, I can't have somebody more fair than me can't exist. So she tells her huntsman, says, hey, man, take her out in the woods and kill her. And when you kill her, take out her lungs and liver and bring it back to me so I know she's dead. That's the original story.
Yeah.
And then
she's serious. She wants receipts.
She wants receipts, and she's witchy. She's going to eat it. She's practicing black magic. So she's... He takes her out to the woods, and he's like, oh, my God, this is just a child. I can't do this. So he says, just run away. He kills a boar and takes out their entrails or whatever and takes it back to her. And then the little girl happens upon this little house with seven beds and seven plates and all that stuff. And it's very clean in the book, actually, because they're German. They're not messy.
Yeah. Very orderly.
Yes.
And of course, they're at work.
They're working. So she's like, I am so sleepy and tired. So she drinks wine and eats off the plates. Like, they had the plates out. And then she falls asleep in a bed.
She's making a mess.
She's the one.
It's very Goldilocks.
Because she's a kid.
Yeah, it's very Goldilocks. She comes in and she's like, oh, I'm so hungry. I'm going to grab one of these plates and, like, fix myself a snack. And let me try. I'm going to try this bed. Oh, this bed's too soft. And it's very that.
Yes.
And she finally finds a bed that's, I forget whose it is. She finally finds a bed that's soft enough and she falls asleep.
She falls asleep and then she wakes up, and then they're at the foot of her bed are the dwarves. And she's like, oh, you're little men. And she tells them her story, and they feel sorry for her. And they say, look, why don't you stay here? You keep the house clean. You cook for us, and we'll give you a place to stay. You figure yourself out. And she does this for a while, and she's happy there. And then the queen one day is asking, am I the fairest of them all? And then the mirror's like, actually... It's like a guy on Twitter.
The mirror is so catty. The mirror's like, listen, B, not only are you not the fairest in the land, but that princess that you thought you did away with, oh, no. She, not only is she still alive, she lives with seven men who think she's the greatest thing since sliced bread.
She's thriving without you, and she can't have that. So then this queen comes up with schemes to kill her. So she, the first thing is that she shows up dressed up like an old village woman.
So the dwarves know that the queen is evil, does black magic, and is out to kill Snow White. Again, because this is a very Grimm's thing. Like, mm-hmm. The children are always warned. Now remember, you don't answer the door to strangers. Now remember, you don't leave the house. And so they warn her and warn her. Now remember, we're going to go to work right now. Remember, you don't open the door to strangers and you don't talk to anybody who comes to the house. And she's like, okay, I got it. And the queen disguises herself as a peddler. In the book and the story, there are three attempts to kill her. In the movie, there's just the one. So, yeah, so she comes first as a peddler, right? Is that what you were saying?
As a peddler, and she's settling this, like, corset or like, a waist cincher thing.
Yeah,
and
a
she's,
corset.
A corset. Yeah. So she's gonna cinch her waist, and she cinches it so tightly that she passes out. And so
she just leaves her there.
And she's like, ha, did it. And she leaves, and the dwarves come home, and they loosen her up, and they're like,
told you. What are you
they're
doing?
Like, now, we told you, you know. And so she goes back, and then what was the second thing?
The second time, here's the thing, is the second time she comes back as a peddler again. And again, Snow White's like, she comes back this time as a peddler who's selling combs.
Oh, that's right.
And Snow White's like, yeah, you know, I could use a comb.
I got a lot of hair. Let's put a comb through it. And then she puts the comb through, and she gets knocked out, and they have to wake her up again. They're like, It's no, poison. Seriously.
It's got, like, poison on the tip of the comb. And again, the dwarves have to come and save her. Like, really? Like, we literally just told you.
So the queen does again. She gets dressed up again, and she's makes a poison apple. And one side of the apple has the poison on. The other side of the apple is poison-free. So she's like, have this apple. And Snow White's like, not supposed to do that. No, I'm not falling for you this time. And she goes, well, what if I eat the apple with you? And then she's like, well, I do like apples. So the queen takes the bite from her side. And then Snow White takes the bite from her side. And then the queen makes sure she's dead. She's dead, dead. And then she leaves. So Snow White's now pushing the daisies, and they come home and they find her, and they're so sad and upset, but they think she's so beautiful and innocent, because she's still a child, by the way. She's still a little kid. They put her in a glass coffin, and they put the coffin, and they go up the mountain, and they take turns keeping a watch on her, being a watchman, and making sure she's okay. It's a lot of work. And so this is about 10 years they're doing this. And,
And she's in that forest for like a super long time. And like people are hearing about it.
Yeah, yeah. And they have to kind of shoo people away and that kind of thing. And then a prince shows up, and he's like, oh my God, she's the most beautiful thing I've ever seen in my life. They open up the glass coffin, and she comes out, and she's like choking on.
Yeah. So what he has heard this story, and he finds the coffin. He finds the dwarves. He's like, oh my gosh, this is that princess. Like it's an actual real thing. And they're like, yeah, it's a real thing. Here she is, man. And he says, okay, you know, I am a prince. And thank you for keeping an eye on her all these years. But really, she ought to be buried, you know, by her father, the king, who's dead by this point. You know, I'm going to take her back for her proper royal burial. And so he orders his folks, his crew, to pick up the coffin and carry it back to the original castle. When they do that, they sort of jostle her about a bit.
Yes.
And that knocks the poison apple that's been lodged in her throat out of the way, and she wakes up.
And she's like, whew. And he says, let me take you to dinner or something. And so they start talking. And then he says, would you like to get married? And she said, sure. You know. And so the next day they get married. And the queen finds out, and the queen's really pissed, because she said, wait a second.
Yeah.
That 10 years ago, I saw her die. What is happening? So she shows up in disguise at their wedding. And then Snow White points at her and says, that's the woman that tried to poison me. So they grab her and they put these molten hot shoes on her feet and make her dance in them until she dies. So it's really intense.
At the wedding, you know, instead of a DJ.
Instead of just killing her, giving her an apple back. Like, they just are like, no, they're going to punish her. And so that's how it ends, is that she basically dances with her feet on fire, and then she's dead. And then, you know, Snow White and her new husband are king and queen. Yeah, they're happy.
Yeah.
But that's the story. That's it. It's all about obedience. It's all about doing what you're told, or you're going to screw yourself up. Walt Disney saw a version of this, and I believe I looked it up. It wasn't Vitagraph. It was Paramount Studios that did 1915. They did a silent movie version of this.
Oh, yes. I've seen a little bit of this.
And it's good.
It is good.
It's quite good. And he said to himself, well, I got to do this story someday. He just loved this story. And it's after, you know, he's doing Mickey Mouse and he's doing all these, you know, cartoons and animated things. And then he's in the middle of the Depression. He says, people need a feature, because the cartoons were doing very well, these little animated snippets that they're putting out. And movies are getting longer. You know, it took a while for movies to gain to a feature length that we call now. They used to be short. Now he's like, well, why don't we do a full movie version of this story? And the way you did it at the time is you had to paint every cell.
Oh my gosh. It's so labor intensive. Like, even just for the shorts, like watching those shorts and thinking about having to draw every single cell.
Single cell. Just to bring it up to his level, because he was also a perfectionist. And he also, it's the middle of the Depression, and he was hiring artists. And they actually just put signs in newspapers and on street, like, we need artists. You know, now women could be tracers, and women could fill the colors of these things.
Yeah, but no, but he wanted artists, Marco, right. Not women.
sense. Women could be models for what they were doing, but most
or voices
and voices. And, you know, they're and they had a lot of women, like I said, doing the coloring and stuff. But he didn't think art was a woman's profession. It was a man's profession. So just so he hired all these men. There were women that were working there as well. But he hired a bunch of men to basically come up with this. And it's everybody. And I'm not diminishing it because it's spectacular. It is
really is. And when you think about, like, there was we've seen how many animated movies have right. you and I seen in our lifetime, and you know, we've never lived in a world without Snow White. That you have if what you've seen is Steamboat Willie,
right,
which you love, or Popeye or Betty Boop, which you love, and then this,
It's
mind-blowing.
Okay, so let's do this. Let's take a quick break. We'll play the trailer. This is the original 1937 trailer with Walt Disney introducing the characters, which it's adorable. And then we'll just talk about this movie.
The picture that every newspaper and magazine critic is raving about. Hear what the usually hard-boiled reviewer of Time magazine says. Snow White is as exciting as a Western, as funny as a haywire comedy. It combines the classic idiom of folklore drama with rollicking comic strip humor. It is an authentic masterpiece. More than 250,000 paintings like these were created by Walt Disney and his staff of artists to make the most daring adventure in the history of motion pictures. With new and amazing characters, Snow White, warm, human, the lovable seven dwarfs. But let Walt Disney tell you about them himself.
Dwarfs' names fit their personalities. This pompous-looking individual is Doc, the self-appointed leader of the group. And this little fellow is Bashful. He's secretly in love with Snow White. And this funny face is Sneezy. He has hay fever. And old Droopy Eyes is called Sleepy. And Happy here with a beaming smile. And old Sourpuss here is Grumpy, the woman-hater. And last but not least is Dopey. He's nice, but sort of silly.
It changed everything.
Everything. So, and if you go to Disney Plus, by the way, and I discovered this yesterday, I forgot about it. Like, you can click on extras for their movies, and often there are documentaries on top of the documentaries that they have. So I was up till midnight watching all these things. So it was David Hand, William Cottrell, Wilfred Jackson, Larry Morey, who wrote all the lyrics, Pierce, and Ben Sharpestein, and then everybody was working there at Disney, and Disney had one of his things he loved to do was he called the $5 gag. If you came up with an idea for a gag that they use in the movie, he would give you $5, and that was like $50 in today's dollar, maybe even more, because, you know, back then, like I said, full on, this is the middle of the Depression. A lot of people came to work there, but a lot of them also said, we thought we'd be shut down any minute. This movie wound up costing $1.5 million, which is like 10 or 15 million nowadays, maybe even more. It was an astronomical sum. And people are like, wait a second, you're making a cartoon and you're spending that much on it? And what's this story?
It was hard to explain to people who had never seen something like this before. It's not like Wizard of Oz, which was, you know, concurrently being pretty. These are happening at the same time, right? It's not like Wizard of Oz, where everybody has read that book.
Mm-hmm.
Everybody knows those characters. Maybe they've even seen plays of it.
Right.
And it's an easier thing to say, like, oh, it's going to be in black and white, and then it's going to be in color, and it's going to be this whole revolutionary thing, and it's going to be the Wizard of Oz. Snow White, which you think of as this short kid's fairy tale, is a totally different thing. And to try to be like, yeah, it's going to be a cartoon, only like an hour and a half.
And we're not going to, I mean, also with Wizard of Oz, we had movie stars in the main parts. Like,
yes, big names at the time. Yes.
Right. And this is like, these were people, they were workers at Disney that did the voices, and they were just singers and dancers and actors that were just like working at the time. It took them several years to make this happen on every level. And on every level, it, I mean, you know, as soon as we were talking about Snow White last week, we were introducing the episode, I was like, oh, is this hi-ho, hi-ho? This is ubiquitous now in our brains. And
oh, absolutely. And absolutely. And I have a question.
Yeah.
I have a question. This is a little bit out of left field, but it didn't occur to me. And Todd brought it up when I was watching this movie this time. What is it with Walt Disney and whistling?
Oh.
Why is there so much whistling? Like Steamboat Willie, he's whistling. This, how much whistling is in this movie? There's so much whistling. Song of the South. You know,
right.
Zippity Doo-Dah. Mary Poppins, Spoonful of Sugar. It's like, it's his cure-all for everything, whistling. Like, if, is there a plot hole? Whistling. Got some exposition we need to get through? Whistling.
Whistling. My so dad was whistling. A whistler. I was used to that.
I'm terrible at it.
Yeah,
I'm
me too. My
when
dad was
a good whistler.
Yeah. My dad did it all day. Yeah.
He must have been. He must have been like a particularly good whistler that he had to like. There's. I can't believe the amount of whistling in Disney movies.
Yeah.
It's weird.
Yeah. One of the things that they do to change things is that they make Snow White older, so she's like a late teen.
Yeah, she's never a little girl. And by the time we start the movie, we've got the stepmother firmly in place and the king has been dead for quite a while.
She's so beautiful,
and
by the way.
You cannot take your eyes off this queen. You know, when she's looking in the mirror and asking who's the fairest of the land, you're like, yeah, yeah.
Yeah, it's you.
I can see why. Yeah, it's you.
Magic mirror on the wall. Who now is the fairest one of all?
Over the seven jeweled hills, beyond the seventh wall, in the cottage of the seven dwarfs, dwells Snow White, fairest one of all.
Snow White lies dead in the forest. The huntsman has brought me proof. Behold her heart.
Snow White still lives, the fairest in the land. Is the heart of a pig you hold in your hand?
The heart of a pig? Then I've been tricked.
No, she's incredibly beautiful. She's incredibly mean. I mean, and Snow White, I don't know if you saw this, at Radio City Music Hall, the movie premiered. The kids got so terrified when Snow White was sent to the woods when the huntsman let her go, and then the woods was scaring her.
That sequence is very
terrifying. They said kids were peeing in the seats. They had to like clean up. But
it's truly scary. I can imagine like if it was on a big screen.
Oh, it's
my goodness.
Because it needed, like we said, people didn't know the story. They didn't know what this was. They didn't know where it was going to go. They didn't know anything about the dwarves. I mean, all of this is new. And so they show up and it's the artistry that's involved here. It's part of it is they had someone who was really good at drawing and had ideas for animals, and Disney loved animals. And he loves to put like a mama and a baby version of an animal or a papa and a baby version.
Because he knows.
He knows.
There. We're all in. The children are like, oh,
look how sweet that is.
Yeah. So cute.
And then he had someone who was from Sweden or Switzerland, I believe Switzerland. And he knew European Gothic and
that architecture. Oh, my goodness. The architecture and the
woods,
the wood carving alone in this film, the animated wood carving.
Yes.
Is so clever and so beautiful. And it's this movie, the art direction is so next level. I mean, just so beyond anything even that would be in a live action. And
right.
This is what I think is so visionary about it, is that, yes, you have these characters who are animals and yada, yada. But the main characters of Snow White and the Queen, and mainly the Snow White and the Queen, mm-hmm. you know, they are really like real humans. They're like real life-size humans. They move like humans. They are really like live actors. What Walt Disney understood, it looks like, what Walt Disney seemed to have like a real instinct for was, you know, with animation, we can do things that no live action film could possibly do, like have the animals like run and try to warn the dwarves, or have dwarves at all,
mm-hmm.
Have the magic mirror look all like smoky and like all he understood that with art, you can do these effects and create these emotions in the audience that you really cannot. The film technology of the time was so limited compared to what he could do with the pen and a brush. He really maxes out the form, and in such a way that he's changing traditional cinema and traditional storytelling in live action cinema. It's just, I mean, you just can't take your eyes off this thing. I don't care that they're whistling for like the 19th time in this movie. I'm here for it. I'm watching all the stuff.
So the movie was just, he had to perfect it as they kept going on. And it's not like they had a screen projection that the Foley department could match the sound. They just had to write down to the second, to the millisecond, every sound, and then create stuff for that. In and of itself, that's a lot of work.
How could you even get through your day if that is your job? The skill.
I mean, we do now in an hour, like for me to put the show together is like I take a file and I put stuff here and take out there. And there, it's like they have to do it all from scratch. The woods look amazing.
The woods are and looks European. It really does.
It really has a sense of place. The music is so catchy.
That's the other thing, is the music is so catchy and so well done and produced.
Hi-ho! Hi-ho!
Aspect of this production is top notch.
She's
unsurpassed.
And Snow White is great. She's
amazing. Okay, let's talk about her for a minute, because this poor woman, she seems to be sort of like Snow White, like a very optimistic, upbeat kind of a person. I don't know what my assessment of that situation is, but she's how did this talent happen? Like the serendipity of how she got this role.
Talk about it.
It's amazing. So her name is Adriana Caselotti. Her father was a vocal, like singing coach in LA. Got a call from Disney Studios. It might even have been from Walt Disney himself. I think it was just from Disney Studios, looking for young voices that could sing in an operatic register. And Adriana, his daughter, not an actress, not a professional singer. She's listening in on the phone extension. And she's like, oh, they're doing Snow White. I like Snow White. They want somebody who can sing opera. Hey, she just pipes up like, hey, that's me. Hey, dad, what about me? I could do it. Hey, Mr. Disney studio guy, I could do it. I could sing operatic. I'm exactly what you're looking for. How about me?
Unbelievable.
What? And so they're like, okay. Come on in, do an audition. And so she goes in to do this audition, and I forget how old she is. She's very young. And Walt Disney is hiding behind a screen because he doesn't want to be influenced by, I think he must in his mind already have what he wants Snow White to look like. Mm-hmm. And he doesn't want the actor's appearance to influence him against picking the right voice. So he's listening, he's hiding, he's listening behind the screen. And I mean, that's the voice.
Right.
That's the voice. And she doesn't look unlike Snow White, but she, you know, it's not her. They had already had the look of the Snow White. But she does have the great big eyes like that. I mean, she's adorable. And she's doing, what I think is really cool too, is that like, that's not like her natural operatic singing voice. She's doing a cartoony kind of she's giving it this like little kind of a cartoony edge for kids, little color of that going on. And it's perfect. Now, it could very well have happened that he picked the voice because the singing voice is awesome. And then when it came time to do the speaking parts of the role, she didn't have the acting chops. She didn't have the voiceover. No, turns out she's a whiz. Turns out she's brilliant.
And she's plucky and resourceful and resilient. I mean, Snow White's great. I mean,
the great performance.
It's really great. And I love Lucille Laverne as the evil queen.
She was somebody who was a very famous stage actress. You know, I think she got her Broadway debut in the end of the 19th century. Like, yeah. she had a lot of experience. And so the different, like, the beautiful queen looking, and then the old crone who comes with the apple. Oh,
and he said to her, so good. They wanted a different sound to her voice when she was being the evil witch, like the old lady crone. She said, oh, hold on. She was behind a curtain. You know, the actors have to be behind these curtains when they're to protect the sound. And so she changed her voice, started doing there. And she came out and they're like, she goes, how was that? And they're like, that was amazing. What'd you do? And she goes, oh, I just took my teeth out.
Because you've been so good to poor old Granny, I'll share a secret with you. This is no ordinary apple. It's a magic wishing apple.
A wishing apple?
Yes. One bite, and all your dreams have come true.
Really?
Yes, girlie. Now, make a wish. And take a bite.
But the dwarves are super funny. I love Grumpy. Grumpy makes me laugh.
Good.
They're
all good.
Yeah. I mean,
the guy that did Sneezy, he was another like very famous character actor. He did films with Laurel and Hardy.
Mm-hmm.
He did a few films with the Three Stooges. In fact, there's one where he does a sneezing gag. I'll find it and put it in the Facebook group. But this was like a bit of his that he would do was this
sneezing
thing. And he heard that there was going to be a dwarf called Sneezy.
So he's like, well, you got to hire me.
I mean, who else are you going to get?
Right.
And he did his sneezing gag, and they were like, well, yeah. Well,
they're all funny, these actors, too. A lot of them work comedy, or they did the Borscht Belt or the vaudeville circuit. So they were ones like $5 for a gag. Dude, I have an idea for you. There's another one. Harry Stockwell is the voice of the prince. That's Dean Stockwell's father.
I know. If you look at them, he looks like him.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. There's a very cute photo. We'll have to dig all this stuff up and put it in the group. Sorry. Adriana and Harry in their costumes. Adriana dressed up as Snow White and Harry dressed up as the prince. They don't look anything like the one in the cartoon,
mm-hmm.
but they're very, very cute. And it's a beautiful voice.
Oh, it's all, I mean, every performance is great. It looks amazing. The effects are great. They're scary. Like, it's scary when it's supposed to be.
It's really frightening.
Yeah.
It's also funny.
And it's sad. Like
the whole thing where she makes the dwarves wash up for dinner.
Yes.
That whole sequence. And let's just talk about animating the water. Like, yeah. They're splashing around. And that is something we take for granted today. These people had to sit there and draw every single
frame,
drop
by
every micro frame. Millimeter. Oh my gosh.
Yeah. And all those, it's seven different dwarves. So it's seven different personalities.
Like,
yeah.
It looks like liquid. Yeah. Then with these seven different characters in the water,
it's just every detail.
It's just mind blowing.
Yeah.
I don't understand how they did it.
Yeah. It was a lot of work. It was a lot of work. And people kept saying in the press, this is Disney's folly. He should have stuck with Mickey Mouse and the short films, short cartoons. He doesn't know what he's talking about. No one's going to see this. It's the Depression. People want this, they want like old time Hollywood musicals. They don't want this. And he puts it out and it's an instant smash. And even like they said, Time Magazine, which hated everything at the time. I think that guy even hated Wizard of Oz. He loved this. They all said it's groundbreaking. And it made $8 million that year. Once again, it was worth, he spent $1.5 million, which at 1937.
What?
So he built a studio.
Yeah.
In Century City, I think
it
was. In Burbank, thank you.
Yeah.
He built a studio and it became a studio. And then he didn't have to depend on anybody. He could just do the things he wanted to do.
Yeah, we should say, like, this movie was produced by RKO. It's not a Disney Studios. He was working under the auspices of RKO. Of course, now Disney owns absolutely everything.
Everything, yeah.
But yeah, so then he was like, yeah, great. Guess what? Now it's Disney. Now it's Disney Studio. How about that?
How do you like that? How do you like them apples? Geez. Yeah.
My goodness.
And then they release a lot of Disney stuff. They release, I think it's like every 7 years or something. They had some number, but they would re-release a movie. I saw this in a movie theater when I was a child. Mom took us.
I did too, in the 70s. Sometime in the 70s they put it out. Given that it's, you know, what we have available to us today, where you have my husband and my son were recently watching the most recent Star Wars movie. Also a Disney property.
Yes,
now.
Yes. Just get Disney Plus. Everything's there.
Disney. And you know, they have they have a completely CGI Carrie Fisher, mm-hmm. for example, right? They have Carrie Fisher who's like totally.
Spoiler.
Sorry. It's not really her. You know, in an age where that's possible, even the voice, like they can even deep fake the voice to sound exactly like. Mm-hmm. Whatever, you know, given that we've now become so used to these effects, and we talked about this a little bit with Princess Bride, when you see something like this that has there's no CGI, there's no, it's all live actors in the studio with the microphone and people with pens and brushes, it's just as mind-blowing to us and groundbreaking today as it was then in its own right. Like nobody would be able to make that today. You just couldn't. It's too labor intensive.
It's so labor intensive, and there's no guarantee that it's going to be any good. That's always like the shock. Like nobody goes to try to make a bad movie, but you can work something to the point where it's unwatchable.
Avatar.
Yeah. Well, the new one's supposed to be, it's getting really good reviews.
So I hear.
I have a friend. I watched it a second time with a friend, and I'm like, okay, this isn't so bad. I'm looking forward to it. But yeah, Snow White. And even like last night, I'm like, okay, I've got to watch Snow White. Okay, put it on.
Same.
And then I'm completely. I know it's beautiful. I'd like to see it on a big screen.
Look away. Yeah. I have to pause it. I have to go back. What is that carving there in the corner in the dark? That's, you know, you can barely see it. And of course, it's somebody probably spent a month and a half like right. making this little cornice in the dwarf's house for me to enjoy in 2022.
It's
amazing.
It really is. It wasn't released on video until 1994 because they were still making so much money with them. Still makes money.
Yeah.
But if you have, by the way, I heard this a few months ago. I think I told you then, but if you own those old Disney cases, those big white plastic cases with the artwork, they're worth VHS, I'm saying. They're worth so much money now. Collectors go, that thing that everybody threw out with the plastics that they had.
My mom threw away so many of those.
I did too. I was like, I can't own everything. And that they're worth a lot of money now. Disney know how to make money.
They really do. They really do.
But this is a case I'm like, you earned every penny.
Seriously. I can't argue with it. Now, Adriana Caselotti, mm-hmm. Which again, let's say she hadn't been like a brilliant character voice, you know, in addition to the singing. The singing is mm-hmm. beyond reproach. You know, he just would have, let's face it, he would have gotten some other woman, some other great character actor to do the voice, the talking parts. Fine. She's amazing. And she was paid like $20 a day, something like that. She basically was not allowed to, she was not credited. She was not allowed to work as an actor under her own name. I don't understand why, if she's not credited, why can't she just go out and act under her own name? Why did then credit her? I don't know. People go back and forth and they're like, well, Walt Disney didn't really know and he was really really though?
He's a control freak.
He's kind of a control freak.
Yeah.
And he did hire her later and she only said positive things about mm-hmm. her. She really loved being Snow White and all that. I don't know. You know, it just doesn't sit right with me. I mean, he didn't do that to Julie Andrews, did he?
She was famous.
She did other voices. He hired her. She basically could only work for him is basically what happened.
Mm-hmm.
There's a, speaking of Julie Andrews, did you see that clip of her with Julie Andrews?
No.
Okay. This I am definitely putting in. I'm going to do that today.
Okay.
As soon as we get off, there is this adorable, it must have been a Julie Andrews television special or something like that. And Julie Andrews brings Adriana Caselotti out. And, you know, she's got gray hair at this point. She's still really pretty. Julie Andrews is asking her, like, tell me about how you came up with the Snow White voice. I mean, she's really giving her the opportunity to talk about this amazing performance that she did. Tell me about how you came up with the voice. And she's like, oh, yeah, well, it's kind of like this. And I added this, da, 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 da. And then, I mean, the woman must be in her 60s, or I think, at this point. She sings it. She sings, I'm wishing, like, way up high, can it higher than I could ever do. And she's singing it with Julie Andrews doing the echo. It's amazing.
Oh, please post that.
Yeah, I will post it. It's so cool. It's so, her voice is still so good. And it's Snow White. Like, you close your eyes and it's Snow White. It's amazing.
People did really like Disney. I mean, he's controversial now. Like, we hear things, but people who directly work for him, everything I've read, like the Sherman Brothers, Kurt Russell,
everybody always says. I know one person who had a very bad experience. Her husband hated working with Walt Disney, and she contended that it was because they were Jewish.
Yeah.
But that's the only, I mean, I've never read any person.
It's the rumor that's been around forever. Yeah. And then I've had people very upset saying, no, I know someone who was in a meeting with him and he was very like, so
people are complicated.
People are very complicated. That's a very good way to put it. Yeah. I have friends that have worked for Disney in the past and didn't love it. But I had friends that worked at the park. I was a dancer at the park and said it was like the best summer of her life. Like, that was the best job ever.
I know people who have had wonderful experiences working in the park and people who have had horrible experiences working in the park. So it's hard to say. It's not a universally positive experience, I guess, for everybody. So,
right.
But anyway.
But for this time.
You can't take away.
No, it's
this movie.
This is a work of art.
It's a spectacular work of art. It is a masterpiece.
It really is.
It completely holds up. It is just, it's so beautifully done. It blows my mind on every level. Like, just apart from the look of it and the sound of it and the performance and the story and all of that. I mean, again, I know he's a control freak, but look what he did. Like, he got all these people, he wrangled them to create this one cohesive masterpiece. How? I don't know.
It's
how
it's he had a vision and he had passion and he was very young at the time too when he did. He wasn't that much older than the people who worked for him. I don't know, he was a complicated man, we can say that.
Yeah I just amazing. Yeah. I'm so impressed all over again. And the Grimm story, I sort of remembered I didn't like, there weren't any big surprises, but
no, I mean, they're
fun to
read.
But it was interesting to learn more about them.
Yeah, I mean, there are all kinds of weird things that happen in these stories, and it's like you said,
folklore. They're very violent.
And, yeah, yeah, I mean, Irish folklore is really gruesome. I mean, mm-hmm. Native American folklore.
Listen, Mexican folklore. Are you kidding me?
Everywhere. I mean, but it's because these stories. Before there was the printing press, how did people tell stories? They verbally did it, and they did it with pictures on a wall, and they just like. These stories kept changing. Yes.
And, yeah.
Every teller absolutely. Has their own way of doing it. And so this was their way. But yeah, her story was told many times in the 19th century. And then here it is presented in the 20th century. And there have been other movies, The Huntsman. There's like a few of them, but I don't.
Yeah.
But I'm not interested. I'm kind of just like, this is
super good.
This is perfect. It doesn't need anything else for me.
I mean, it's got all the themes of the original story. It's a little bit different in that, she's never a little girl.
Right.
But that's fine. You know, I think it works fine for the movie.
And the prince is cute and she's not like a ditz. He's very brave. He's earned her hand in marriage and she's really nice. I like all of it. What can I say? It's a great movie. I mean,
it's great. It's great. I mean,
groundbreaking. I'm saying Snow White is great, but seriously, if you haven't seen it in a while, watch it. It's
super good.
It's really good. I'm going to say the movie.
Yeah, oh, definitely. Definitely.
That's not even.
So we have a fun choice for our next Disney in December.
Yeah,
we're very excited about this, too.
Yeah, we got our couple planned out. We're doing The Little Mermaid next, and it's based on a Hans Christian Andersen tale.
This was one of my favorite stories when I was a little girl.
Yeah, same.
And I liked how dark it was. I liked, I don't know, I was really into that when I was a kid.
And the movie, we'll have things to say about the movie, but the music in the movie is...
Again, like beyond reproach.
I mean, the performances
the music and the performances are outstanding. Spoiler alert. But we'll talk about the different. There's a lot of differences in this case. I would say even more than with the Snow White story. There's a lot of liberties that.
They take a lot of liberties.
This version of the Disney Corporation is taking with folklore, and that's going to be a fun one.
And then we're doing, because this had this awesome suggestion in the Facebook group, That Darn Cat. That's going to be the last one, which I'm excited about. We're getting a paperback, so it takes a little longer, so that we're going to do that the next one. We're looking for ideas for January, the new year, February, African American History Month. We might do musicals in March again. We'll see, and everything's coming up. So please send us your suggestions, being my point, all those different places that I mentioned before. And Margo, where can they find you?
You can find me online at coloniabook.com, and all of my social media callouts are at She's Nacho Mama. And where can they find you and purchase Filmed in Brooklyn?
You can find me at Brooklyn Fitchick on Twitter and Instagram. My site is brooklynfitchick.com. I'm at Margo Donahue on TikTok. And if you're interested in getting a signed copy, I can get that out to you. Email us bookversusmoviepodcast@gmail.com, and I will send you the deets, or just order it wherever you get your books. No worry from me. And it's on Kindle as well, by the way. And thanks to the Daily News, they did a really nice feature on me. I was tremendously shocked when I saw
it. That's amazing.
It was really good.
So excited to see that. That's cool.
So yes, it's been great. It's been great. Aww. So we're gonna have a great time with our next episode, The Little Mermaid. Take care. Be good. Hi ho. Thank you so much for listening to the Book Versus Movie podcast. We are a part of the Frolic Podcast Network. You can find more podcasts you will love at frolic.media/podcasts. We follow the hashtags LadyPodSquad and PodernFamily. If you want to support the show, you can go to our Patreon page. Go to Patreon and look for Book Versus Movie Podcast. We have a basic Facebook page, but we also have a private Facebook group. Go to Facebook and type in Book vs. Movie Podcast Group if you want to join that. You can follow us on Twitter and Instagram at Book vs. Movie. Spell all those words out. If you'd like to send us an email, it's Book vs. Movie Podcast, spell that all out, @gmail.com. You can follow Margo D. at Brooklyn Fitchick on social media, and Margo P. at She's Nacho Mama. Thanks so much again for checking out our show, and we'll be back soon with a new episode.